Before I get started, I have to make a brief confession that I am a MOOC dropout. and that is no reflection on the MOOC I was actually attempting to complete. So initially, MOOCs, mass open online courses, were topics and that you would find in trade journals, and occasionally, you know, a few years ago, we would see some references to them in Chronicle of Higher Education or Inside Higher Education. And then, of course, we all know that there was an explosion in a few short years, and all that changed, in which politicians, philanthropists, educators, parents, and students debated the merits or weaknesses of MOOCs. Representatives from Coursera, Udacity, and a host of others, countless others, flocked to universities to offer pitches and ideas, and administrators would bribe us to attend these events with lunch or breakfast because we're easy. But today, we have four historians who have long engaged in MOOCs at different levels and have either taught or written or commented on them. So what we'll do is I'll introduce the panelists who will offer some presentations. And we do have one of the panelists, Jeremy Adelman, is en route. So we're going to go a little bit out of the order in which the was listed in the program. And after the presentations, we will open it to all of you, because I assume that there will be a quite lively conversation. So first, I would like to introduce Philip Zelikow, who is the White Burkett Miller Professor of History at the University of Virginia. There he's currently the dean in the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. He is a former trial and appellate lawyer in Texas. He has his doctorate from Tufts University's Fletcher School, and he was also a career diplomat serving overseas and in Washington, and he also was on the NSC staff in the White House of President George H.W. Bush. During the most of the 1990s, he taught at Harvard University, and after going to the University of Virginia to direct the research center and teach history, he did take two leaves from academia, returning to full-time government service. He directed the 9/11 Commission, and as many of you know, the Commission's report was a finalist for the National Book Award in nonfiction. In 2005 to 2007, he was the counsel of the Department of State and a deputy to Secretary Condoleezza Rice. His books include Germany Unified and Europe Transformed, A Study in Statecraft, the Kennedy Tapes Inside the White House During the Cuban Missile Crisis, as well as Essence of Decision. Our second presentation will be by Jonathan Rees, a graduate of the University of Wisconsin, who is professor of history at Colorado State University, Pueblo. He is the author of Representation and Rebellion, The Rockefeller Plan at the Colorado Fuel and Mining in Iron Company, 1914 to 1942, and most recently, Refrigeration Nation, A History of Ice, Appliances, and Enterprise in America. His writings, as many of you are familiar, on MOOCs have been published by Inside Higher Education, Slate, and the Chronicle of Higher Education, where he's a regular columnist. He is also proud to have completed Jeremy Adelman's World History MOOC in fall 2012, but he forgot to ask for his completion certificate, so hopefully that will maybe be taken care of here. Ann Little is a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania. She is the author of Abraham in Arms, War and Gender in Colonial New England, which was recognized with an honorable mention for the Albert B. Corey Prize, awarded jointly by the American Historical Association and the Canadian Historical Association. She has published articles in the New England Quarterly, 18th Century Studies, and the Journal of Women's History, and she has held a number of fellowships, including at the Newberry Library, the Huntington, and Massachusetts Historical Society. Her current research is focused on the life and times of Esther Wheelwright, an English girl taken captive by the Wapanaki and who became a nun, choir nun in Quebec. She also blogs about history, feminism, and academic life on Historiann. Lastly, who we hope will be here very soon, will be Jeremy Adelman, who is Walter Samuel Carpenter Professor in Spanish Civilization and Culture at Princeton University. He is a graduate of Oxford University and the author of many publications in the field of Roman philosophy, the Odyssey of Albert Hirschman, Frontier Development, Land, Labor, and Capital on the Women's March of Honor in Canada and Republic of Buenos Aires and the Legal Transformation of the World. He is also a co-author of the World History textbook, one that I frequently use, Worlds Together, Worlds Apart. So again, we will start with the presentations. They will be brief, anywhere from 10 to 15 minutes. And then when, even if we have finished the presentations, and Jeremy Adelman comes in, we'll allow him to also address
all of you. All right. Can all of you hear me okay?
Yes.
Even over the din of the rival presentations? All right. Let me first start off, what is a MOOC? A MOOC is an acronym that stands for Massive Open Online Course. The notion of actually doing courses that are available for people to watch at their leisure is not a new idea. This has been done, for instance, on television in the Open University format, going back really even 40 years. The UK in particular was a pioneer for this. Some of you have also heard of the DVDs one can buy from course companies like The Learning Company, now renamed The Great Courses, which by the way markets more than 100 different history courses that, by the way, are widely used for personal investment and have some devoted admirers. By the way, Bill Gates is one of them who loves those courses. And he's basically tried to teach himself in humane letters in his sort of this second career. So, in a way, MOOCs are another extension off of this idea that leverage certain developments in online technology and also incorporate a large social network feature in which people who are taking the courses, which are offered somewhat synchronously, that is, the courses are offered in real time, though you don't have to download them or look at them in a particular day. But if you want to get in the social network commenting on what's going on, you kind of need to sort of keep up with it on a more or less weekly basis. So, massive open online course. Let me now deal with a couple of widespread myths or misunderstandings about MOOCs. First, very important to keep two different conceptions in mind. One conception is of a pure online course in which the teaching is done only through the online format and the accompanying social networks. So the pure Coursera platform, currently available for free in that model. There are other models that are not available for free, especially in areas like certain science and business education and vocational education, where, by the way, this stuff is used quite a lot, both asynchronous and synchronous online education. If you ask how your physician passed his recent recertification boards, what courses he took to do that, he may give you an answer that has something to do with online education, for example. But then there's another concept that is actually marries the online vehicle with classroom instruction in some sort of partnered and hybrid format. What I did was both in my course. If you were to go on the Coursera platform, and by the way, this is highly unusual. If you go on the Coursera platform, what you'll find usually is a courselet, a piece of a course, usually 4 to 6 weeks long, that almost kind of different on a spectrum of edutainments. Jeremy's course, like mine, actually ran the entire length of semester. Mine actually has 14 weeks of material. Put out over 15 weeks. It's actually in lock sync with a semester, because actually it was used in partnership with an actual semester class. Jeremy's is a little bit like that too, was not quite that long. That is highly unusual in these platforms, courses of that length, and require an unusual commitment from the students in order to stick with that through the length of a particular course. But it's important to keep these two different concepts in mind. They have different audiences and different purposes. the reason I mention all that is actually the primary purpose the University of Virginia spent money on my course was as an experiment in the second model, not the first. We were actually, and we are still working on different ways of trying to crack the problem of how best to deliver large survey classes in which the large lecture hall format has certain strengths and weaknesses, but you still want to couple that with in-person instruction. And this was a kind of test bed in which to play that out that had the spillover effect of creating quite a lot of free course material that you could make available for personal enrichment to an audience around the world for free. But a lot of other people have different concepts in mind, but you should understand ours. And you understand why we spent money on these. Another widespread myth and misconception about these is that universities see this as some way of saving a lot of money. Not my university. These are not cheap. Any university that tries to do this in a really serious way very quickly discovers that if you want to do this well, it is not cheap. It is a significant upfront investment to do this well, and it requires constant attention and work to do this well. So it's not so much that this is a gigantic money-saving device. It's actually a device to solve, to deliver certain kinds of instruction in ways that then give you certain advantages and take advantage of innovative possibilities. Or not, depending on what your conclusions are about this experiment. So now let me just tell you a little bit about my personal experience and just share that with you. Again, to demystify a little bit of the MOOC. You'll often see people advertise their registration numbers for their courses, which are huge. These numbers are meaningless. Anyone who tells you they mean something is not giving you the full truth. People sign up for these courses, it means no more than to say that they will sign up for courses that they have no intention of actually using and never actually even look at. So the only interesting number is not a registration number. The only interesting number is how many people actually try out the course. That is, even go to the bookstore and so much as pull the book off the shelf and look at the jacket. We'll even watch as much as 5 minutes of your course to see if they're interested in it. In my case, that number, despite the not whatever the nominal registration number was, that number was somewhere in the 30,000 range worldwide. And we actually have some decent data on where those people are around, were around. It's kind of interesting. But it's worldwide. Of that, say, 30,000 who actually kind of looked at the course at least for a few minutes, my course has had then, and will have in its next running starting this month, had then 92 video segments over 14 weeks. It will have 94 in the next running. Various slight adjustments that have been made, learning from experience. So about 30,000 people looked at one of them. Of that number, I would say only about 15,000 people decided to give the course a serious try, about half of them. Remarkably, and by the way, my numbers, I think, are much better than the Coursera average for this, is I actually had a retention rate out of that 15,000 that decided to really give it a college try, so to speak. About 10,000 more or less stayed with it for the whole duration, more or less. Watched almost all or most of all of the segments, about 10,000 out of the 15, which over 15 weeks and 92 videos, that is a big time commitment for people to make. So just worth keeping that in mind. Out of the 10,000, about half of them actually bothered to sign up for and earn a formal certificate accomplishment, or about 5,000. Out of the remaining 5,000, a lot of those people are online auditors. I'm not bothering with the quizzes, I'm just taking this for my own enrichment. And a number of them, about one-fourth, say 2,500 of those people, are not actually participating in it online at all. They're downloading it and they're watching it offline. They don't appear in any of the online numbers. They're not taking quizzes and so on, because they're not participating in it that way. They're downloading it to watch on their iPad on the train, or things like that. And so they're participating in it offline, but they're still part of this. So these are, by the way, we did surveys of the people who took my course. The response rates were high. I had like 5,000 responses to my mid-course survey. It's a pretty good response rate. A lot of data. Hundreds of, some of the questions were open-ended, so the responses makes up hundreds of pages of material. And it was, I will tell you that my experience in teaching this group of people around the world is the most gratifying teaching experience I've had in my whole career as a teacher. And a lot of people have found this. I touched a lot of people's lives and they told me so, in any number of ways. Emails, flowers, letter, handwritten letters, testimonials, all unsolicited. Things they would write to my bosses, to the board of visitors, and the stuff, you just read a few hundred of these, and it's just the kind of stuff that any teacher goes into the business to get. And that part of this work, I was, my university's perspective, they regarded this as basically what I was doing in my spare time. By the way, since I'm the dean of the graduate school at UVA, I'm not even supposed to be teaching at all. So this is all just kind of an overload that I was doing this for reasons I won't bore you. But incredibly gratifying experience. But in a way, one of the more interesting feature of it was what it allowed me to do and what I learned about this process in flipping my residential class, which I did at the same time using this material. And what I just want to do, if you'll hang with me for about another 5 or 7 minutes, is just to tell you a little bit about that design, because in some ways I think that conceptually is the most interesting thing that I did, is how I reinvented my residential course leveraging this material. All right. Standard model history course. All of you know, professor lectures to a large and relatively passive group of students, let's say 120 students. Okay. Revised model, what I did is 92 online pre-recorded one-on-one style presentations. These are not just paid lectures. Any of you who looked at my stuff, or this is, I'm sitting across the table from you as if you were in my office getting a tutorial with my bookshelf behind me. It's actually, we actually use my office to take it. In the standard model, I run presentations where I'm managing extemporaneously classroom technology. And hopefully I'm not screwing it up in the middle of my lecture while I'm trying to juggle managing my power, you know, whatever I'm doing on the screen with whatever I'm trying to deliver. And I'm doing it extemporaneously and hoping it all holds together. Revised model, I can prepare and do a much more elaborate integration of media, including writing on my slides, zeroing in on maps, pick parts of paintings, animating maps, animating movements to be able to help. And I can carefully prepare all that in advance and go through multiple takes to get the presentation right. I did not use a script in what I said, but these are not done in one take. In the standard model, your lectures usually have to fit into two time boxes, because that you're in an industrial system that's assigned you a time box and a classroom box, usually like 2 times 15 minutes per week. So whatever content you had has to be simply grouped into 2 15-minute segments, right? In the revised model, I do topical presentations, which the students can view on their schedule, by the way, in varying lengths depending on how much time I want to spend on the segment, and with the total time per week also varying, which might have been anywhere from 100 minutes a week to 200 minutes a week, because I wasn't bound by the classroom time boxes anymore. And I could cut up the size of my segments in a way that made narrative sense for how long I wanted that segment to be. Coursera likes their people to keep it short, 10 or 12 minutes per segment. Some of mine would run as long as 30 minutes. But I think if the narrative holds together, you hold your students' attention for a longer space of time. My average was about 130 minutes a week, which is probably what I was trying to cram into my 2 15-minute blocks in the old system when I was chronically running out of time and speeding up at the end. In the standard model, students get one chance to listen and take notes on your lecture. In the revised model, they can play the video again, stop, pause, or if they find it really boring, speed up or skip. They can slow down for note taking. They can freeze on a map or a chart that they want to linger over and try to puzzle through a little bit more, or as I say, fast forward. In the standard model, I have assigned readings that are either weekly groups or linked to each of the bi-weekly lectures. So I've got to take my readings and basically clump them into either a weekly clump or a bi-weekly clump. And it feels like homework. And they may or may not do the readings in conjunction with the lecture, of course. In the revised model, I cut up my reading assignments into slices geared to the segment presentation. And because they're watching the presentation at home and doing the reading at home, it can become a seamless kind of homework of reading and viewing together for that segment. If you think about this a while, this is actually quite a remarkable change in the way you can change the way students cognitively take in this material. And you can cut this up into your video forms and then link the readings to that. In the standard model, and this is another big point, who does the follow-up explanation on your big lecture? Why grad students do that? Your TAs do that, at least at my university. They do. That's what everybody else in my department does, is the TAs do the follow-up explanation. What I do now is they get the follow-up explanation from me, the person who's earning the big bucks, supposedly because I'm such a wonderful professor and so wise. I do the follow-on explanation on this lecture material, which they've already watched, and which I can then also quiz them. So that's significant. You think about that for a little while too. In the standard model, how often do you actually test them on their recall and understanding of a lecture material? Usually, unless you do in-class quizzes, which most history professors in my department do not, you test them only two or three times per semester on the midterms and the final. In the revised model, I test their recall and understanding of it in every single one of the online presentations, so more than 90 times. Now this has, the psychologist will tell you that this kind of testing and recall exercise has really important cognitive effects on the ability to internalize material. In the standard model, by the way, the same thing is true for your readings. I actually do a core of, and when I flip my course, I actually quiz students on the readings when I meet with them in person. By the way, I never meet with them in a classroom of 120. Because I break that into tutorial segments. And I only meet with them in groups no larger than 60, so that I can hold meaningful discussions. You see, in a way, I'm doing the TA sections. But then, what do the TAs do? I don't discard the TAs. I use the TA time now to create a whole new dimension of my course that never existed before, of history labs, where I actually have created bodies of primary source material on 10 different cities around the world and have students doing historical studies about the development of those communities at different points in time during the semester, and then relating those to the macro themes in the big lectures, which of course in a modern world history class are always going to be at 40,000 feet. And so that actually becomes a whole different added dimension to the class. The students, by the way, self-report that in my class, compared to other large lecture history courses at Virginia, they work 50% harder outside of class in my class than in the other large lecture courses. So, huge front loading, a lot of faculty workload associated with this, a lot of student workload associated with this, which actually raises some challenges and some problems and stresses for the students. Their work is also much more synchronous. Instead of their work spiking around the times that they're cramming for midterms and finals, you get them into rhythms where they're actually being tested and working almost constantly week in and week out in conjunction with the video material if the class has been well designed. Now, what I want you to just think about in kind of reflecting on this experience as I am is this is an experiment. But the experiment has two important features you need to juggle and keep in mind. One feature is the pure online feature of it. And whether or not that either my material or other kinds of course material can usefully be delivered in this online format. Many of my students thought the answer to that question is yes, Whether or not that's superior to being in person, I don't know. You can see from what I've discussed, there are some pros and cons, depending on the quality of the experiences on either end. But I'm offering it personal enrichment for free, and a lot of people found it enriching. And a lot of what we're about, of course, is we care about the students, don't we? And whether people are getting a chance to learn. The big point to keep in mind about that, about the pure online, is the potential to reach the vast body of students who want this education and who are not between 18 and 22 years old, which is most of the world. And it begins to transform your whole notion of who is the audience for university education. Then there is a second concept as an experiment in flipping classrooms and whether you can use these techniques to do innovative class redesigns. In my case, and I taught this course for a number of years before, I'm highly satisfied with this experiment and will repeat it this spring, tinkering and learning all along. I'll stop there.
Before we go on to Jonathan, for those of you in the back, there are seats up here in the front, and there are some seats in scattered throughout.
So make yourselves comfortable.
Come on up close. There are plenty. The front row's wide open. Just like undergraduates.
I know.
Don't be afraid.
Don't like
come
the
on
down
to
row.
The edge.
We don't
like you will know and will not put you on the spot. Okay, I think
everyone's done. All right, terrific. I should say to begin with that I am also a MOOC dropout. I'm a MOOC completer and a MOOC dropout. I dropped out of Phillips class. I did actually watch the lectures, and I've got to say there's an experience that I don't want to repeat because he makes me feel very inadequate about my own lecturing. And the fact, I'm glad to hear there's more than one take of that stuff, because if anybody could lecture that well off the top of their head, I would really worry about what I've been doing with my own students. But before I actually get into my paper, I actually want to thank the person who's not here at the moment, Jeremy Adelman. I did complete his course in fall 2012, and I blogged about it. I have a blog, it's called More or Less Plunk. And I decided that I would blog about the experience while I'm taking the class so that more people would get some sort of feel for what a MOOC is like if they don't have the time in order to complete it. And I guess I'm not surprised that Jeremy Adelman found out that I was doing it, but what I was surprised is that he decided to read everything I did and respond in the comments. And we had this incredibly rich discussion, me and Jeremy and all the people who commented on my blog, interdisciplinary, I might add, plenty of people from other disciplines who are interested in what MOOCs would do to the future. And it went on for, I think I spent more time on some of the comments responding to Jeremy than I did on the original reports of the post. If you're interested, and I think it's a really interesting historical artifact, the blog is moreorlessbunk.wordpress.com. The category is World History MOOC, so you have to sort of go down and to the right and hit the category and go back, and it's from fall 2012. And we really had an extraordinary discussion. And even though I'm sitting here block sniping at him, he was never anything but incredibly gracious and helpful. And he taught me a lot, and I hope I taught him a lot. We'll see when he eventually comes in. About what this can be or what this should be. And it's just one of the really interesting experiences that I've had of being involved in MOOCs. And I really think that's probably the genesis of this panel, is that experience a year ago. And a lot has changed with respect to MOOCs from, you know, the beginning of 2012 when we had to submit this proposal, and now when we're actually doing the papers. But nevertheless, a lot of what we talked about back then I think is still very much relevant. So I am not going all that long. This is about 7 or 8 minutes of just sort of, I'm an ex-labor historian, so I'm bringing back some of my labor interests and discussing with respect to MOOCs and how this affects academic labor in general. Like so many people today who want to disrupt higher education, Frederick W. Taylor fashioned himself as a reformer. He wanted to change the American workplace in order to take command of the shop floor out of the hands of the many workmen and place it under the absolute rule of management, thus superseding rule of thumb by scientific control. By cutting prices on goods despite paying the most productive workers more, this kind of reform was supposed to benefit labor, capital, and especially the public at large. To me, massive open online courses, or MOOCs, represent the potential for the tailorization of the academic workplace, and are therefore a threat to the rule of thumb judgments upon which the historical profession depends. None of the historians sharing the podium with me today risk being forced to operate under a stopwatch, nor do I suspect that they want anybody else attending this convention to be subject to similar working conditions. But the tailorization of the academic workplace could very well occur at cash-strapped public universities like mine, where MOOCs might be accepted for credit or used as an educational tool in for-credit classrooms. Anybody who pays attention to the vast literature on educational technology should be familiar with the term unbundling. Education reformers use it to connote the kind of division of labor and specialization that Frederick Taylor studied and valued so much. Why should anybody provide content for their classrooms, they ask us rhetorically, when the best professors in the world could be piped in via the internet? This, they argue, will allow professors in the less prestigious colleges to concentrate on giving students the individual attention that they deserve. There's recent vogue for flipping classrooms. Is having students watch videos of lectures as homework instead of listening to professors lecture during class time is not necessarily MOOC-related. As Philip has illustrated, MOOCs can be used this way too. Despite the fact that MOOCs have been a hot topic for well over a year, there are very few history MOOCs compared to the number of MOOCs in other disciplines. Jeremy Adelman and Philip Zelikow were two of the first historians to sign up to run MOOCs with a major commercial provider, yet very few historians have followed them down that path. While I admire their willingness to experiment with new technologies, I think the reason for the relative lack of history MOOCs is that the obvious perils associated with this particular experiment have scared most of the rest of our profession away. Consider the possibility of flipped classes in history. When approached with the possibility of flipping my own classroom, I always ask, when will my students have time to do their reading? Students at Princeton or the University of Virginia might be willing to make time to watch lectures and read textbooks or monographs, but it is always a struggle to get my history students to do any reading at all. Loading them down with taped lectures only makes that possibility more remote. Both Professors Adelman and Zelikow have been experimenting with flipping their own classrooms, as you've heard already, and I can tell you Jeremy is doing the same thing. This is an ideal situation as they are both experts in the particular world history content that they choose to teach. Unfortunately, any other historian making use of their content will have to adapt to their particular historical content preferences. I can't help but wonder whether students will understand who their real professor is in this situation. Yet this is only one way that MOOCs could deprofessionalize or de-skill large segments of the professoriate. Historians who do not select their own content or write their own lectures could easily be replaced by personnel with less training, perhaps graduate students or people with no training in history at all. Perhaps the schools that license history MOOCs will hire no on-site teaching help whatsoever and simply let students fend for themselves. As a result of such possible sacrifices, the same deprofessionalized fate could even await the professors who run MOOCs. The faculty behind one psychology MOOC offered by the commercial MOOC provider Udacity utilized, and I quote, a Udacity employee to turn their lectures into scripts complete with demonstrations and jokes, unquote. The head of the Harvard-MIT MOOC collaboration, edX, has even suggested that Hollywood stars might run the MOOCs of the future because, and I quote again, really good actors can teach really well. That's a true quote, yeah. If MOOC providers avoid assigned reading because it isn't sexy enough to attract tens of thousands of eyeballs that they can eventually monetize, then why not bring in Matt Damon to lead a class? The commercial logic behind both decisions would be exactly the same. I recognize that nobody involved in this discussion, here and elsewhere in academia, welcomes the outcomes that I'm sketching. that anybody who doubts that such scenarios are possible hasn't been paying attention to the higher education press for at least the last decade or so. Desperate times breed desperate measures, especially when cash-strapped administrations are involved. Undoubtedly, such measures would be undertaken in the name of efficiency rather than any kind of pedagogical necessity. There is no question that MOOCs might be good for teaching some subjects to some people. Computer scientists, for example, seem to love them to death. However, sacrifices have to be made in order to teach a history MOOC, and many of those sacrifices are designed to save the cost of additional pedagogical labor. In Professor Adelman's course, all the required MOOC essays are graded by peers, rather than by anyone trained in history, including his grad students. Professor Zelikow has eliminated the essay grading labor problem by foregoing written assignments entirely. I understand why such sacrifices are a practical necessity to run a MOOC, but I hope both of these professors would agree with me in suggesting that the best possible history education requires direct personal contact with a trained historical professional. Eliminate that professional attention, and it's not really college-level history anymore. It's worth noting precisely why MOOCs threaten student access to professional attention. Aaron Beatty, a postdoc in comp lit at UT Austin, who has written extensively on MOOCs, summed up my attitude on this particular kind of academic capitalism well in a blog post he wrote in early 2013. The MOOCification of higher education, Beatty writes, could be done well, I think, but it won't be. Instead of using new technology to do what we've always done, but to do it better, it will be so thoroughly co-opted and driven by venture capital that it will be another battering ram against what's left of high-quality, low-cost higher education. And it will destroy subjects and disciplines that aren't conducive to being MOOCified, like mine. I would argue the same thing is true for history. For historians, the key word in MOOC is massive. History professors can't teach what our discipline does best if we have to do it for tens of thousands of people at once. History MOOCs require sacrifices in the name of efficiency and financial expediency that no credit-awarding university should tolerate. To ignore the fact that some schools will do so anyway will not only make it harder for the next generation of historians to find jobs, it is in effect an insult to our collective expertise, because it will distort the definition of what professional historians do for a living beyond all recognition. Thanks.
In the description of this panel in the AHA's online program, which of course I had to reference before I wrote my paper because I couldn't remember what Jonathan had asked me to write about, he invited me here today to discuss the aspects of face-to-face education that MOOCs can and cannot duplicate. I really tried to find things that MOOCs can and can't duplicate about face-to-face education, but I couldn't think of a single thing that MOOCs can do as well or better than face-to-face human skill teaching. So I think I'll stick to talking about two things that MOOCs can't do. First, MOOCs obscure the real work of teaching in ways that undermine us all professionally. And second, MOOCs can't teach difficult or controversial subject matter as well as professors or teachers working on a human scale can. Finally, I'll finish my comments today by comparing a new MOOC that Coursera will debut this spring its face-to-face counterpart from last spring that will serve as a good example of the gap between real teaching at the college level and what MOOCs appear to offer their subscribers. And when I speak of this, I think that Professor Zelikow's distinction of the two ways we need to think about MOOCs is really helpful. I'm only talking about sort of the broadcast online content. I mean, to me, I was very intrigued by his experiments with flipping the classroom and the stuff that he did in his face-to-face courses. I thought that was fascinating. And I was already thinking while he was discussing his ideas about what I can do when I teach my 120-person survey course next semester. So I'm not talking about sort of the stuff that's happening in his face-to-face, personal scale, human scale classroom, but rather just sort of the possibilities of the broadcast medium through the digital technology and through monitored online discussions. So first, professors at underfunded state universities, and here I'm sort of maybe transitioning from Jonathan's presentation, borrowing a page out of his book, but professors at underfunded state universities like ours, and perhaps some of yours, have assumed a kind of a defensive crouch over the past few decades. The political attacks on tenured radicals were clearly of a piece meant to soften us up for the budgetary attacks that have hollowed out our cores and created a casualized faculty majority. Many people in my state actually think that we only work the 6, 9, or 12 hours a week that we spend in front of a class. It's bad enough when we hear this from politicians or other self-interested commentators, but sometimes we even hear it from people who should know better, like the provost of Colorado State University of Pueblo, who rhetorically asked his faculty last summer, "In what other job can you get away with working only 3 days a week?" In the face of this kind of attack on our profession, we need to explain what exactly it is we do in order to become and remain effective teachers, and why this ongoing work is important. Defining teaching only as the work we do while lecturing to a class, leading a discussion, or supervising other classroom activities is an astonishingly narrow view of education, both our own ongoing self-education and the education of our students. So right now, I will say, I will confine my comments today only to the work of teaching that we do and ignore the important work of research and service that regular faculty are, in most places, required contractually to perform as well. So I want to acknowledge that there is also that other work which certainly enriches our teaching and informs our teaching, but I am going to stick strictly to the work of teaching for today. Now, because MOOCs are mostly about recording lectures delivered by super professors, they feed the lie that produces teaching to lecturing, and that while lecturing, we are indifferent to our audience and care nothing about their comprehension, confusion, or questions. Recording professors' lectures and creating attractive promotional videos appears to be the main thing MOOCs have focused on, but this captures only one element of teaching, I would argue. Real learning doesn't happen only during a lecture, or even necessarily in the presence of a professor, and sometimes not even in lecture. A great deal of the learning that our students in human scale classes achieve happens on their own time and inside their own minds as they work through the reading and writing assignments on our syllabi. Because my undergraduate classes have usually no more than 30 or 35 students in them, I can hold them accountable for out-of-class work by learning their names, answering their questions during lectures and discussions, responding to their emails, commenting on and grading their written work, and being available in office hours and outside of class to help them. This, and not lecturing, is the real work of teaching. And unless or until MOOC vendors can figure out a way of making super professors have superhuman endurance, or stretching time so that they can have a super long work day, whereby they might stay in contact with all of their students and hold them accountable for their work, MOOCs won't transform anything in higher education, at least not in a good way. Most people can figure out how to deliver an effective lecture, and that's part of teaching undergraduates at the university level. But the much more challenging and time-consuming part of our jobs is all of the other planning, thinking, reading, grading, commenting, consulting, supporting, and advising we do outside of class that is central to effective teaching. That kind of teaching can only be done on a human and not on a massive scale. Now, a second concern I have about MOOCs is the diversity of the subject matter they can offer. While MOOC providers have offered an utterly reasonable, and Professor Zelikow himself, an utterly reasonable critique of large introductory courses at big universities as impersonal, textbook-driven, and regurgitatory in their assessment requirements, MOOCs appear to replicate all of the disadvantages of the large, impersonal, textbook-driven intro course, and most offer little innovative in return that wasn't available with VHS tapes or DVDs of the greatest courses of all time. The demands of the MOOC, and particularly its massiveness, work against introducing students to the latest cutting-edge research and conversations happening in our profession because MOOC professors will be asked to offer only the broadest and most inoffensive courses out of fear that courses on certain subjects won't sell. Courses on slavery or genocide, courses on gender and sexual minorities, and courses on non-white people in general in countries in which college-bound people are for now majority white. These are also the kinds of courses that are the most difficult to teach even on a face-to-face scale because of the different political views and life experiences of our students. Now, I'm speaking as someone who teaches courses on women's history and gender and the history of sexuality. So that's my perspective. And I have serious doubts about the breadth and the complexity MOOC history courses can offer their students. What happens in my classes, which feature some of the most shocking, depressing, and unsettling subject matter in my department's curriculum, is that students frequently need to talk about, or at least hear other students talking about, the reading material that I've assigned. A number of the readings, particularly those having to do with sexual assault or sexual identity issues, bring up complex and difficult feelings in my students. And several of them need to talk about this with me or with the other students in the class in order for these issues to be engaged, not just emotionally, but also intellectually. There must be a level of trust and good faith between the professor and the students, and ideally among the students themselves as well. However, MOOC super professors don't know their audience, and to MOOC subscribers, their super professors might be just merely flickering images that they watch on their computer monitors or mobile devices, or fast forward through their lectures. I suppose it's hard to know what exactly students are getting out of one's lectures and how they're processing that information. So my question is, would students actually read articles or books that focus on the victims of warfare, disease, or rape if they were assigned in a MOOC scale course? Would the students be angry that the reading material didn't merely reflect the point of view of generals or victors in the contest for continental or global domination? Would they just skip any readings that offer anything but the reassuring Whig narratives of progress, liberty, and justice for all? Or would the professors of these courses never consider even assigning readings that are challenging or even painful, knowing that there's no real mechanism for ensuring that students do anything at all in a MOOC? If a MOOC in women's history or the history of sexuality were offered, would the material polarize the students in the online discussion groups and turn them into typical internet shoutfests featuring the deluded sinners on the one hand versus the intolerant bigots, right? Or the feminazis versus the mansplainers? One course that would appear to challenge my theory here is Stephanie McCurry's History of the Slave South that will be offered through Coursera this semester. When I looked at this course on Monday morning, there were no peer-reviewed assessments nor group projects required, and there was also no specific information about how any other assessment might be offered or how students might be held accountable in order to get their free certificate of completion from McCurry's MOOC. The course requires no secondary source readings, only primary sources in the public domain and available free of charge. Online, obviously. Participation in online discussions is required, but it's unclear how those are structured and who might be monitoring them on McCurry's behalf. I would be curious to see how those discussions go. How will students handle the shocking, frequently sexualized violence and virulent racism that structured all Anglo-American slave societies? Will the students be capable of carrying on vigorous debates about the historical material, or will the challenging nature of some of the readings, if any of the students actually do the readings, and the challenging nature of some of McCurry's lectures as well, will this polarize the class and shut down any meaningful exchanges? McCurry's MOOC appears to be fairly rigorous for a MOOC, but it pales in comparison to the righteously challenging syllabus for her History 170, The American South to 1865, The Rise and Fall of the Slave South, which is her real life course that appears to be the basis for her MOOC. In the spring of 2013, McCurry required her students at the University of Pennsylvania to read 6 books, including 2 monographs and 4 book-length primary sources, or source collections, as well as a substantial number of primary and secondary sources posted on the course Blackboard site. Additionally, McCurry students at Penn are required to attend and participate in weekly recitation sections, and to submit a midterm and final exam, as well as an 8-to-10-page research paper. Even in a large lecture course, and of course with the assistance of a large army of teaching assistants, I don't think there's any question that the face-to-face course at Penn is a more rigorous and therefore a much more effective class than the Coursera version. That's because real education takes real commitment from both the professory and her students. Real skin in the game, and that includes time, money, books, and assignments that get real feedback from the professor, or at least some TAs, which admittedly is not ideal, but for people who teach in large universities, they are probably unavoidable. Now, this is not a knock on McCurry, or Professor Zelikow, or any of the other people who have collaborated in producing MOOCs. It's merely a statement of fact that MOOCs, in their online broadcast version, are in no way comparable to the face-to-face, human-scale courses we not-so-super professors teach every semester.
A MOOC, and I think that the position that visualizing a MOOC as a means of which to draw the general public into the study of history in a way that is accessible and enlightening and interesting to them on the basis of the themes and the topics, which we all want to do. As Jim Grossman is constantly saying, there aren't 3 million Americans running around researching their family anthropology or sociology. I would argue they are researching their family psychology. More important is he also has mentioned that there isn't an anthropology channel, there is a history channel, and we know there are multiple aspects. So there is a growing interest in history as entertainment. But also as a means of which, as we have people retiring, they are interested in learning and to go back and learn about things that they were interested in that maybe they didn't have time to undertake a study when they were working as, say, an electrical engineer. Jonathan captured some of the professional issues about MOOCs as they intersect to the universities and colleges, particularly as seen a panacea for all that ails. Whether financial or about credit hours, all of those things. And then Anne captures some of the ethical implications that are that most of us are dealing with when we're teaching sensitive topics in the classroom, how that would translate into a MOOC. But also that distinction between what a professor does, say, in the classroom in a brick and mortar class versus in a MOOC. And so those are some of the issues I think we're all wrestling with. The Washington Post and the New York Times, when Sebastian Thurn called Udacity a lousy product, and there was, of course, a collective cheer that just went across the land, where everyone's like, finally, people are talking about some of the issues. But one of the things I think is really important and that has helped in these conversations is for all of us to think about what we teach, how we teach, and what we do in the classroom or online. And I think Philip really talked and addressed that distinction about the MOOC versus his flipped classroom and how those are different. And I think Jonathan and Anne also touched on some of those similar things. Within the AHA, for the past couple of years, we've had a project, the Tuning Project, in which we talk a lot about of doing history. In my own institution, St. John's, and some of my colleagues are here, we have spent a lot of time establishing new goals and outcomes, meeting with stakeholders, which would be potential employers of undergraduate history majors. And one of the things that kept coming up over and over again, especially when they saw our new goals and outcomes, was that this looked like a job ad for an entry-level executive position. And when we heard that, we knew, okay, we're doing something right. That there is something that we do to write as historians, and there is something we're doing right within the department in the creation of goals and outcomes. We also met, these are very small groups, so this is something we'll be returning to off and on. We also run on focus groups with students. And students are always intrigued by online material. And some are actually better at using them than others. We're all surprised by that, aren't we? And that, but frequently, as chair of the department, I constantly, at the end of the semester, deal with students complaining about their grades in their online classes at a significant level. And I will ask them, they'll say, well, I made an A on the exam. And I'll say, did you post? They said, no, why would I do that? I'm busy, that's why I took the online class. So they don't many times recognize that this is the means where you have the interaction with them, is through the postings and the online discussions. They think it's about taking the exams and maybe writing a group paper or something like that. So running the focus groups, what we found is that students want to learn contact, want to learn content through project-based learning. That was repeated over and over again. And just like us, what we discovered is that they want to get their hands dirty doing history. And I think that is something we have to kind of consider as we're moving forward. And I'm not really sure how that will fit into mass online courses or exclusively online courses. So the students are essentially reiterating the reason that all of us became historians, about the things that interest them, really that act of doing history. Going in the archives, or working with materials, and handling book mold and things like that, and just doing the actual. And I think that is where we're trying to have that show. So I would like to open it up to the floor for questions, comments, rebuttal, celebration. Passive acceptance.
Hybrid models worth exploring, or are there certain ways? Online education is being used widely now in a variety of ways, including in professional and vocational education at scale. So, and obviously lots of people are getting important professional benefits out of that, mostly because they're in situations, like most people in the world, where residential college education is not a meaningful option at this point in life. And the notion that we deny those people education because they can't get it in the prescribed format is an interesting argument. So here's a simpler way of posing the challenge to you. I'll just ask you a question. How many of you prefer live music to recorded music? Just raise your hand. How many of you, turn it around, how many of you prefer recorded music to live music? Actually, are a few people, several people, okay? Half a dozen. The interesting point is that for those of you who prefer live music, I'll bet most of you actually value your collections of recorded music, however, just the same. No one thinks that going to a Bruce Springsteen concert and listening to a Bruce Springsteen album on a CD is the same experience. But believe me, Springsteen wants to be in both those lines of business. And you're okay with the fact that he wants to be in both those lines of business. Think about why. So, the notion that that you can't have a coexistence of live and online education is just kind of something you just have to step back and examine. In what other area of life do we have this argument? And in what other area of life do we also not bemoan the way the technologies can be misused? For example, history on television, or even history in books, which are also rather passive and individualized experiences. But to the other part of your question, which is important, is this issue of community and chemistry in the classroom, which is true. And which is, by the way, one of the downsides of the online experience. That's one of the things you lose, in part because, as I say, people can't go to the live concert. But what they can do in the MOOC format is they can have the social networking capability. The social networking capability loses the extemporaneous in-person live quality. What do you gain? You gain the participation in a much larger and more diverse community than was possible. In my course, I had an online community reacting and commenting to my lectures, and modern world history is pretty far from being happy talk. It's not like, oh, smiles and Whig theory and nothing but progress and triumph and no, we have some fairly difficult stories in modern world in history of the last 250 years. And there's a lot of graphic imagery that we use to dramatize some of those stories. And it affects people pretty strongly. And they want to write about it. And they talk about it in social networks. And so people who are, for instance, reacting to the story, let's say, of genocides in Armenia during the 19-teens, are writing about that. And then people in Turkey are answering. And in Armenia. Now, my students in Charlottesville, Virginia, don't get that experience very much. So you have communities of people participating in discussion about the course material. Often, a lot of it actually is still just, like, what's going on here in northern Italy in 1860? I don't understand. And Italian students will get on and will answer their questions, by the way, much better than I probably could. And people like Latin American revolutions and questions, and you get participation from students in Venezuela and Argentina in these social networks in real time, dialoguing with students in Alabama and Canada and Australia about issues in Latin American history. Now, that's a different kind of chemistry that you're gaining. So there's a trade-off involved there, and you're getting two different quality of experience.
Yeah, just to be perfectly fair, there's a whole different type of MOOC that we haven't talked about yet. It's a connectivist MOOC developed by George Siemens and Stephen Downs in Canada starting in 2008. I don't want to break into educational gobbledygook, so I don't want to sort of try to describe all the differences, but it basically, from my understanding, is it stays at around 2,000 people and is based on the kind of class dynamics and interpersonal contact that you just have it online. And as MOOCs go, I kind of like it. I would like to run a class with an online component where students are breaking off into small groups and doing projects together. Oh, there's a digital storytelling 106. You should Google it if you're interested in this sort of thing. But these are non-commercial ventures. And I think what's happened, certainly with respect to MOOC Talk, these big commercial the educational gobbledygook for this is ex-MOOCs has sort of forced all this talk about C-MOOCs, the connectivist MOOCs, off into the sidelines. And my experience with the Canadian model is that the people who practice it are sort of angry that the American commercial companies have co-opted this. And in a way, that's sort of my fear about MOOCs and regular classes, that over time, even if the people involved have the best of intentions, the worst models are going to drive out the better models. The bad will drive out the good. Maybe it'll take a year, maybe it'll take 10 years, but when you put the commercial imperative into education, I think we've seen with respect to adjunct faculty over the last 30 years, that's the sort of thing that's going to happen, and pedagogy isn't going to be as much as an issue as it should be.
Do we have another question or comment?
Going across a thought like you is, and I apologize, I was a few minutes late from another conference, so if I'm covered or running, I'm kind of just shoving up. Your analogy was very interesting, and I thought about, I wonder if it's valid. You talk about participation in the artistic experience when you're at your Bruce Springsteen concert. There's no way I could back up sing for Bruce Springsteen by sight. So, and the thing that I've always valued in education, at least in my best educational experiences, was, yes, a relationship with my fellow students, but the relationship with a professor who I could look at in the eyes and ask a question to and get response from, that dialogue, which, is it possible to be a professor teaching how many thousand students and be able to look at students in the eyes with them? So your argument, I guess, is that, well, it's just a different experience. But I'm wondering if it isn't cheapening the educational experience, that dialogue, in a way that when I listen to music on a phonograph, you know, I can't be at a concert all that evening, so it's the next best thing. But it's not like an educational experience, which involves, you know, I'm sitting back with the professor.
Your point is valid, right? So that kind of dialogue, that kind of in-person tutorial, is the beau ideal. So that ideal is often actually not the reality, even at the University of Virginia. I mean, just we're talking. I'm a dean. We have a lot of different kind of classes at my university, and we have classes with hundreds of students in the classroom, and they're kind of the quality of their dialogue with their professor is not so high. To be just really blunt about the actual classroom experience of most freshmen and sophomore students in most of their classes at my university, maybe yours are better. But that's, so it's, they do get that kind of dialogue experience with graduate students more often, and sometimes that's great and works marvelously, sometimes also not so well. So I don't, there is an idealized version of this that is wonderful and cannot be replaced and should not be replaced for anyone who can afford to find their way into that room and into that moment, because they have a particular time in life and the money or the capability to be able to get to that place. So what about everybody else? What's up with them? The people who can't quite get into that place at that moment of time with anyone at this table? What do we have to say to them and to their educational interests and to their educational needs? And then that's part of the challenge. Now, the social network, I would go on the forums, of course, and I'd be commenting, you know, every week at what people are saying. That's not ideal. It's not the same as if they could all fly to me and go to my office hours. By the way, the majority of my students don't go to my office hours. I may say something about me, I don't know. But I bet some of you have had this experience too. And you understand why that happens. And it's not necessarily even a comment on you. They have busy lives. But this is it's a spectrum of educational opportunity that's being made available to audiences in different ways and with different qualities and with different trade-offs. And this is actually a really interesting challenge, frankly, for educators to think about. is what about the students who are not between 18 and 22 years old and cannot afford to go to a decent university, or for one reason or another, they're not at the right, they're just not at the right place to do that. Are good universities interested in teaching those students or not? And if they think that those students and their lifelong educational needs are worth addressing, which is, by the way, the vast majority of humanity, if those are worth addressing, how do you plan to do that in a meaningful way? Now, if someone can come up with a good solution to that, there's going to be a lot of interest in that. What the astonishing thing that we're seeing, and the reason that I have these thousands of students devoting inordinate amounts of their personal time to make time to just try this out and find it enriching, it's the one thing that's so impressive, they are so conscientious. So many of these students, remarkably conscientious. They are just so hungry to learn. Now, maybe in my case, they made a mistake in judgment about where to go. But you got to respect that hunger and that thirst and honor them. And think about how as educators, we want to connect with that and address that in the best way we can.
In the very back, and then there was someone back there.
I have a question about, I went to a few other teaching panels so far at the conference, and one issue that came up earlier that I think is relevant here is this question of teaching content as historians or teaching skills, and right, there's a lot of conversation about how these are not mutually exclusive and that kind of thing, but it does strike me that when we're talking about teaching and learning, right, there's the question of what the instructor is doing, but there's also the question of what students are doing, and I know that, you know, it can feel really great to sort of make sure that our students have access to information, but it's really difficult to tell the extent to which that access to information has advanced their cognitive skills, their emotional development. So, and when I think about right teaching, like what we're doing while we're teaching, a lot of it is intervening at crucial moments where you can tell a student is stuck in a dualist form of thought, right? Or they don't understand that some opinions are more are less opinions than others, right? Because of such as evidence, and to being able to, like being able to intervene at those moments is something that happens if you're thinking about what your students are doing. So I guess I don't know if you guys have ideas about how to ensure, right, not just that like the radio signal is going out, but also that it is doing anything to the history brains that we're trying to develop in our students.
Well, that's why I think that face-to-face human scale teaching is so important. And I would just say, with respect to Professor Zelikow, maybe you don't have a lot of non-18 to 22-year-old non-elite students at your university, but there are a lot of institutions around the country, in my state, including my own, and community colleges that do serve a lot of those people. So it's not like we have a choice that it's MOOCs or, you know, Amherst College. It's not quite that clear. You know, it's not either personal, human, face-to-face courses for everyone, but only for a very few, or I should say for a very few, and then MOOCs for the rest of us. There are, you know, the U.S. higher education system is incredibly diverse, and I'm sure that many of you probably work with students who are non-traditional students, returning students and the like. And so I mean, there are other ways of serving those constituencies, and we've been serving them in many cases for a century.
Well, let me engage us in a little bit of a dialogue about this. This is a terrific point. So imagine that you're an administrator of a community college. I taught at a community college when I was in graduate school. It was one of the ways I made ends. I don't think that experience is all that unusual. So you have a choice. Is that you can hire graduate student me 30 years ago to teach. Imagine who teaches a modern world history course in community colleges. Just think about that for a minute. And I think your honest answer is going to be quite a lot of variation there. And you're not going to like a lot of what you find. Actually, my daughter took such a class at my community's community college, and it was not a very happy experience. So then you have, suppose there is some MOOC product on. And you as an administrator are evaluating, like, what am I going to do to handle the modern world history class, or actually the intro macro class? which is a, another stock and trade in the community college business, and necessarily so, or intro to accounting, all right? And you've got some, or circuits and electronics. And you think about, how do I, what's the best way I deliver a quality education in intro accounting, modern world history, intro macroeconomics, you know, that kind of class to my community college student, given the relevant faculty I can hire versus this, or versus various partner models, where I might anchor, use some of that, but anchor it. Or one alternative is, no, you graduate student, you just do that. And by the way, that might work out really well. Harvard Extension uses graduate students to teach intro to accounting who have an MA, not an MS. But an intro to accounting class is a pretty standard class. By the way, they teach that online, incidentally. But it's virtual online. You see the range of options and things that are coming up now in the real world and the choices people make. And what's happening here is that some new things are coming into the mix and into the game here. And you should just ask yourself, or you can consider as an administrator, what options do you want on your menu? Would you like to be able to have or adapt Michael Sandel's justice class into a community college framework if it was available in some partner form? That's an interesting question.
Whose decision is that, though? Is that the administrator's decision, or is that the decision of the professor who's teaching the class? There's a very important distinction that I keep making, at least on my blog, between MOOC producers and MOOC consumers. The University of Virginia is both a producer of MOOCs and the senior class is a consumer of MOOCs. Stanford won't give credit for its own MOOCs. And there's a big difference there. And my fear, and it hasn't become reality yet, thankfully, but my fear is that at some point, there's an administrator who's going to say to a historian, you go flip your classroom with this person's content now. And once that precedent is busted, all of us, whether we're going to be replaced by a MOOC or not, will lose one of the prerogatives that have been part of the historical profession for 100 years.
There's in the back, and then somebody in the middle, and then someone there, and then Peter. Okay, and I'm
going to
stand up so I can see.
I think seriously, the concerns that you raise about MOOCs and how it can negatively impact the educational experience, but I'm concerned that the tone of the discussion feels rather reactionary, and if we, as professional historians and educators, dismiss the phenomenon out of hand, then we lose control out of our ability to participate in it in any reasonable, in any measurable way. And isn't it better to have a stake in the game than to decide that you hate the game and it ought not to be played in the first place?
That's a good one. It depends on where you sit, right? If you're one of the people who will be MOOCified out of employment, then no, you really don't want to be somebody who's has a stake in that game, because that game is going to prevent you from putting food on your table. I don't blame anyone who's teaching their own MOOC for teaching that MOOC. And indeed, if you could create a giant firewall between MOOCs for people outside regular college age or outside the regular college experience and college credit, I don't think I would have organized this panel. I would have no problem with them whatsoever. They would be just the next generation of history courses on DVD. The problem is that it's in college where the money is. And it's obviously not the super professor's money. Yeah, you're not making extra money teaching this class. I know Jeremy had said when we were talking about this in the comments to my blog, he doesn't get a cent for teaching a MOOC. It's the money from the MOOC providers. Now, Coursera has something like $60 million worth of VC money that those VCs want money back from. And they're not going to get it giving college classes to people who don't have access to college, because if they start charging, a lot of those people are going to just disappear. They're going to get the money back by giving college credit. And it's not going to be at the University of Virginia, and it's not going to be at Stanford. It's going to be at community colleges and going up to a certain level in the higher education hierarchy that hasn't been determined yet.
Yes,
ma'am.
Thank you for what you said a second ago about that. I mean, we're talking about something that already exists. I'm really with it. Young people are already doing, whether they're associated with an educational institution or not, if they're excited about learning, whether they're young people or non-traditional people who are reformatting their lives and careers, it is happening. The thing that I find most compelling is a different version of what you were saying about social justice. Because the people who will be most capable, in my opinion, who will be most capable of profiting from a variety of online education opportunities, whether it's MOOCs or TED Talks or whatever it's going to be, are people who already had what the French call formation, something that makes them capable of doing what in education is called executive decisions. They know how to discipline their time, they know how to read, they know how to do critical analysis. Whether I do that with my students on a face-to-face basis or not, their ability to profit from my teaching or the teaching of a professor depends on all sorts of stuff that happened before they ever came to my classroom. So whether that happens to my classroom or whether it happens when they go to somebody's MOOC is, to me, the most critical part of why this needs to be an absolutely public discourse. Because I could see, in terms of a sort of apocalyptic, walking dead sort of scenario, a situation where the students that will be lost, whether those students are traditional age or not, will be the ones who haven't got that professor. They don't have that preparation to self-educate with the content and the available training that can be done. There's all kinds of things that can be done, laboratory stuff that can be done online, you know. But they don't have the ability to use that. And that, I fear, will gut a generation and maybe two. So that the ones, my fear will be that it really will create a worse kind of lack of social justice. So that the people who are capable, they've had sort of a, you know, wealthy background, middle to wealthy background, they've had a good education, they can profit from it, and there'll be people out there floundering who maybe want to learn, but they don't know how. And so I feel so strongly that part of what we should be doing as historians and in the other field is really being advocates for education in any form, and I mean real education, not just content out there digitally, but the reality that education is costly, whether that cost goes into preparation of a digital format in some way, or whether it's face-to-face contact. Education is expensive, and if we are going to be a nation that, I know I'm sounding like very soapboxy, but this is a part of it that I'm not hearing, that it's not a war. Administrators can save money at the institutional level to perhaps, but at the larger macro public discourse level, we've got to be part of a voice that's saying it's going to be very expensive if we're not, as a nation, supporting education broadly. And that's what I'm not hearing. And I don't mean from you all, but I mean in general. And that is what's most concerning.
Well, this is that's a wonderful question. So there's actually a very interesting issue. Do MOOCs widen participation in education? Or do they actually reinforce social inequality? Because they're mainly taken by people who already have college degrees and above. That's actually the case with my course. And therefore, they just become one more way in which you widen social inequality, because you're allowing even educated people everywhere to get still more, in more ways. This is actually, though, a very interesting question. One of the interesting ways to see this question is to look at the K-12 level. How many of you here have heard of the Khan Academy? All right, a number of you. So this is, if you haven't, it's worth, if you went to a session like this, it's worth taking a minute and looking up the Khan Academy. Millions of people in the K-12 world now are using Khan Academy courses. Khan Academy courses are having a very interesting impact on school reform issues in inner city schools in K through 12 as ways of, and actually there's a lot of interest in flipping classrooms and more flexible education forms in inner city schools because of the constrained circumstances of kids and the opportunities to actually offer more adaptive educational environments that are better suited to the difference, to the, frankly, we have educational structures that make it very easy to get on the off-ramp and very hard to get on the on-ramp for lots and lots of kids. And so these flexible educational forms, unbundled in the Khan Academy case, are actually proving very interesting and very powerful in that space. And some of this, I think, is going to come into the higher education world, too. But it has both these potentials. It has the potential to reinforce inequalities, and to, but perhaps also to widen participation and make education more literally democratic. And it may be partly up to you here and lots of other people to decide which of those outcomes becomes the predominant theme.
I think that's a really important point that you raise, and I know that Jonathan and I have spent a lot of time conversing online in public as well as privately about this very issue, about the issue of social justice and inequality that MOOCs raise, and that education, you know, that raises in general. I would just say, maybe like a lot of you, I teach at a university where I teach a lot of first-generation college students. And I feel like a lot of the work that I do is kind of teaching them not just early American history and women's history, but it's teaching them how to do college. And I think that I'm much more capable of doing that in a human scale contact with students rather than a MOOC scale. And so I think, what was the study that came out from the University of Pennsylvania that said that 97% of all enrollees in MOOCs already have a bachelor's degree? I'm not against people doing, you know, continuing education, or I'm not going to, you know, when I become dictator of the world, unilaterally shut down digital lectures. I think that's terrific. You know, there are a lot of members of my family, I'm sure, who in retirement would be very interested in doing some of this stuff. But we're talking about, you know, fundamentally very different populations. And I think the question of skills and preparation for being able to learn from a MOOC and to self-educate is a really important question.
Just very quickly, I always say there's a political economy to this issue. There's a wider social political context that all of this higher education reform operates in. And if you're not looking at MOOCs in that context, you'll have no idea what MOOCs are going to do to higher education in the future.
That was a question I wanted to raise is related to the idea of who does make the decisions. That it's not only history professors who get to decide, professors of anything, but that it's administrative people, some of whom may not have been in classrooms for a very, very long time, and occasionally ever, really. And I was hoping somebody in this room would remind me of what exactly happened with San Francisco State. Weren't they going to offer credit? And decided not to, or they did
San Jose State?
Oh, yeah, San Jose State.
Yeah.
Let's see if I can do. Well, there's two San Jose State stories. One is their experiments with math, which didn't go very well. That was with Udacity, and which is what led Sebastian Thrun to say it was a lousy product. And then it was back in April where the Michael Sandel justice controversy came in. And that story was that the administrators, licensed, I think is the right word, Michael Sandel's edX course on justice and said to the philosophy department, essentially, you guys should teach this. And then they wrote an incredibly elaborate, which I think was actually quite moving, 4-page open letter to Michael Sandel explaining why they don't want to teach this. The problem is, and if you looked at the articles accompanying the response to that letter, is that the administrators at San Jose State then offered it to the English department, who were teaching philosophy now, or acting as the, for lack of a better term, teaching assistants for Michael Sandel's philosophy course. And I think it's great that people have access to Michael Sandel's philosophy course all over the world. I just don't think you should get college credit for it. I mean, there's just a huge distinction for me right there. I don't want to take anybody's MOOCs away. But you know, we as, Tara's saying this word, professors as workers, need to understand what's going on or we await a very difficult fate, trying to make a living as time passes.
There is another San Jose State story having to do with circuits and electronics.
Oh, I don't know that one.
This is actually one of the most important. They actually are doing an experiment to see whether or not there are cognition gains in using the MOOC format versus the standard lecture format. Since there's a standardized circuits and electronics class that has standardized tests, it sets itself very well for some interesting studies in ways that none of my courses ever could, where they can actually test, and they're actually finding some significant gains in the MOOC paired class, in which uses a MOOC developed from material or in the MIT course on circuits and electronics, used at San Jose State, in which that course has gotten statistically significant gains in the number of students passing and comprehending the material against basically the homegrown version of this. It's a, you do come back to these issues of who decides. The Sebastian Prun story has gotten a lot of play here. You may not be fully aware of the sequel to this, which is he's just going into the for-profit vocational education game. He's not getting out of online education. He's just going into a more profitable niche. And he's just going to concentrate his products there, and you're just not going to hear much about it. But he's still going to be purveying those products to eager audiences willing to pay plenty of money for.
I was struck as I listened to this about an AHA session in 1998, way back in New York. I was at Phi Alpha Theta luncheon, and Gordon Bachman sort of told the story that at Cal State Bakersfield, a professor had been done his course, and the course had run, him being filmed. The problem was he had been dead for years. And when you brought up the Khan Academy, and your last point, and I guess that's because I'm president of the Teachers Association of Medical School, I see some real dangers in looking at the MOOC and looking at some other things. And exploring the issue, I agree you don't want to not be have your hands in the game. But I think the danger, and we already have such a horrible gap in the inner cities and high schools, the danger of squeezing the teacher out so that you could have some canned product and the manipulation of data to prove that it works or it doesn't work is such an explosive issue. It's just been fascinating to listen to your discourse.
So, Jeremy, I'm going to use that question to catch you up on what you missed. I think we've concluded, and I led the way in arguing, MOOCs might be useful. We've also heard the argument, MOOCs might be dangerous. And there have been significant commentary on both of those themes. There.
I agree.
That's fair.
Sure. I'm so sorry. It's a 2.5-hour train ride. I just took 6. So I apologize. I'm not even going to pull out my paper and maybe spend 5 minutes.
I count 15.
Okay, I get 15? Okay. Then, first, I'll talk a little bit about my personal experience and then reflect on some of the larger issues. And I should say that I don't have really strong opinions on the larger issues, just as a punchline, except to say that we need to watch what we're doing very carefully and learn. My attitude to the whole enterprise is experimental at this stage. So I taught last year and I just finished teaching once more version 2.0, a survey of world history since 1300. It's a Princeton course that is both offered online openly to the rest of the world as well as to Princeton students who are incorporated within it. So it serves dual functions within one, under one umbrella. My motivations were twofold. One is that I noticed that more and more of my students, as many of you I'm sure have this experience, are taking their notes on laptops, and I'm competing with Amazon and Facebook and ESPN and all the rest of it. And you know, some of my colleagues, the policy was to require that students close their laptops. I had always said to students that I didn't want to have an adversarial relationship with them, and that it was really up to them to make the judgment call about whether to pay attention to me or the argument with their boyfriend. And of course, that was kind of a losing proposition because the boyfriend's always more interesting than I am. But just as a chance, I happened to have to pre-record a lecture for, it had nothing to do with MOOCs. I didn't even know what the word was at the time, what the acronym stood for. And it cued me onto the idea of occupying that digital space. And then I started to read much more about digital learning. There was a very interesting, for anybody who's, I know that this thing is being recorded for the George Mason Center for Media Studies, just really on a tangent here, hackingtheacademy.org, really very interesting venture on thinking about humanities, digital humanities. Anyway, back on track. Wanted to invade the laptop space of my students. The other was that I have a part-time job at Princeton as the person who oversees the university's internationalization, and I wanted to experiment in global learning. And most of my time in that capacity is spent negotiating MOUs and that sort of thing, but I wanted to try a more microcosmic approach, which was to try to internationalize learning by bringing the world into a course for Princeton students, and to increase the intervisibility between Princeton students learning in campus and their dialogues that they could have with students around the world. So rather than thinking of international learning requiring study abroad, bring the world into the course. And since the course was about the world, that was very convenient. The course then consisted initially of mainly three components. Pre-recorded lectures. So have you already given the spiel on your experience as a consumer of this?
No, but I think the comparison between your two courses is actually very interesting.
Okay, well, so I did pre-recorded lectures. Well, I know you did too, right? In a recording booth, we can talk about that if you want. The second was students had to write papers every fortnight, and they were peer assessed. We can talk about that too. I have some thoughts, and not great ones about it, but I do. And then the third component was these online forum discussions between the students themselves, which I had really high hopes for. I thought that was really the promise of global learning, was that the globe could talk to itself in these online fora. I know you had those too, and they were very active. That was version 1.0. What did I learn? In a nutshell, the lesson for the wider world is that the part that worked least well was the papers, I felt. Peer assessment is really complicated, and I think I was certainly very naive in thinking that I could just give a handout on how students would give each other feedback, and it really doesn't work that way. And there had not been a whole lot of thought about that in very early days on the Coursera side. This, by the way, was a course offered on the Coursera platform. There hadn't been a whole lot of thought about it, for reasons we can go into if you want, much of it having to do with the incumbent courses being larger from the STEM fields and not the humanities courses. And there was very little experience on the Princeton side for all kinds of reasons. And so we really had to learn about peer assessment. What did work was the forum side was, I think, a very effective learning device for the rest of the world, and my sense was on the whole. Students enjoyed the lectures, though it was relatively passive. But they understood that was part of what you do when you take a course. On the Princeton side, what worked well, the students really liked being able to take the lectures in the shower and eating their Cheerios and wherever they wanted. And their exams really showed, for the first time I'd seen in over 25 years of teaching, that they got a lot out of the lectures. Because they pause them, they took notes that really showed up there. And I was very, that was the eye opener. So these lectures really helped the students. What did not work at all for the Princeton side is that Princeton students did not go out into Planet MOOC and talk to the rest of the world. They still thought of these as two separate hemispheres. And so the hope that I had of doing global learning for Princeton students really didn't pay off at all. And that was really my fault, because I hadn't baked into the course any requirement upon which they would be assessed that would involve the students going out into the world in this digital space and having conversations with students out there. So version 2.0, in a nutshell, tried to address both of those issues. I was most concerned about the Princeton students. So we spent a lot of time designing interactive features that the Princeton students would put online in the form of weekly blogs that Princeton students would put out there for the rest of the world to comment on. And I'll wrap up here by saying that experiment was great for the Princeton students. I mean, the Princeton students really created wonderful, incredible dialogues. My whole experience of in-classroom teaching changed as a result. What we say at Princeton is we went from flipping the classroom to flipping the course. All of us were all in digitally. And it was really exciting. I think we're still learning about what we can and can't do. The students really felt that they could be very creative. What broke down was the relationship with the rest of the world. And there, I think it had to do with some of the changes in the ecosystem. Princeton is really one of the few institutions, and I don't know, did you give out certificates for your course of accomplishment? Or
no credit. No credit.
Right. We gave nothing. And I think we had, initially it wasn't so problematic in version 1.0 because there were not many courses out there. Now there are lots of courses, lots of certificates, and there was a lot of a sense that Princeton wasn't reciprocating for the students who were attending the lectures, even fulfilling the requirements, and they weren't giving out it, and they were doing it for certain. Some of them were saying it's like wallpaper. I love to put these things up.
It's a symbolic, psychological way of
it. I'm engaging them, and they were disengaging in a big way from the Princeton students. The other is that there are a lot of courses. A lot of students are signed up now for many, many courses at once. And there, my fear is for the lifelong learners that are out there, they're taking a relatively passive approach to the opportunity, are essentially watching our lectures but not really engaging with all of the other material. The course has literally just ended. So that's my very preliminary assessment of how version 2.0 worked and did not work out. I'll wrap up there, and we can go back to the Q&A. And I'm really so sorry.